in the beginning these beautiful words on our program, which I think are really inspiring for our work. It's by Rudolf Steiner. Now our culture will become ever more unhealthy, and humanity will more and more have to make out of the educational process a healing process against all the things that make us sick in our environment. We may not allow ourselves to indulge in illusions about this. Of course, we need also a lot of civil society activity to strengthen everywhere the seeds of the good, seeds for a change. There is so much awareness today for the good. We can even say the more we lose beauty, health, the more we start to appreciate. So therefore, we have so many valuable initiatives on the environmental level, even in ethical banking, ethical business, ethical leadership. So new trademarks will develop based on moral status. And really, signs and securities that these initiatives work beyond corruption and beyond egocentrism. So this is really something we can highly appreciate in our time, but on the other hand, we see also how many children are already so severely damaged just by the media abuse, by neglection, by just materialistic life circumstances, who make disappear what really human faculties and possibilities are. And therefore, I'm particularly glad that in such a central point like Hawaii, here in the midst of the Pacific Rim and area, we take the time to focus on truth, on beauty, on goodness, in a way, in an orientation, how to bring them more relevant into everyday teaching, everyday working with children and youngsters. But also, we are almost adult, aren't we? Also among us. Because when I am invited in world of schools, so that is Europe, maybe in America and the Pacific area, it's rather other circumstances, but in our schools in Europe, people like me are invited primarily in our days to talk about teachers' health, teachers' strength, the change of the profession, how to cope with the more difficult environment, more and more requirements from bureaucracy, burnout syndromes, and a generation less and less good to handle. Mm-hmm. So that's how it is. And you know best how is it in your school, but one lack of force is that the adults are not sufficiently able to form a strong working community in their schools, built on trust, built on support, and built on individualism. I wonder why we have on our banner World of Education towards freedom, towards individualism, but then if we are sitting together in the faculty, we want to treat everyone equal. And if someone is exhausted, then we say, why are you exhausted? Look at me, I did this and this and this. And then we start to compare and lose our sense for individuality. So even among us as adults, I think we have a lot to improve. Following the question, what is really true here? And how can we create the way we work with one another more harmoniously? You know, what is beauty? Beauty, of course, is one of the biggest symbols of our time. All the young people have their own sense for beauty and want to be in their own appearance as beautiful as possible. But what is the characteristic for beauty? I hope we will enter into this theme more and more during the days. It seems easier to approach truth, to approach goodness, than to approach beauty. Because beauty seems, in the first approach, rather very individual. We have a proverb in German, a proverb, you can fight among tastes, among aesthetic judgments. Each one has his own aesthetic judgment. There are no general characteristics, what is beauty or not. It's a matter of like or not like, quite individual. But beauty is as clear as connected with the two sisters and brothers, truth and goodness. All the three have a resonance in one another. Beauty without truth and without goodness is not beauty. Mm-hmm. Truth without beauty and goodness is not really truth. And goodness without truth and beauty, what is that? So they are familiar with one another. Although in our own human being, they have their own realm. Truth we associate with thinking and observation. Beauty we associate with our feeling life. And goodness with our will. And therefore, we can already touch the biggest mystery of the three, and that is the I, the human I am. Because it is the I who looks for truth. There is a beautiful poem by Christian Morgenstern. Those who are looking for truth have to go alone. So if you are a teacher and you have a certain amount of students, in my class where I was socialized, we had 46 students. Quite a crowd. Today it's different, I know. But if a teacher is this lucky, then all his students have their own approach to understand something. So, truth is in the middle. And I will never forget when I asked Georg in my beginnings as a school doctor, after my first hospitation, seeing how children are dropouts in the teaching, how they start to sleep, to occupy, you know. It is not the rule that all the students can really follow the whole teaching. And I asked my husband, Georg, but how did you do in math? 40% are dropouts in math, along statistics. How do you manage? How one can teach that? What is really teaching and reaching everyone? And he said, I had a wonderful introduction in Good World of Education when I had my first World of Block as a young math teacher. Coming freshly from my academic education, ninth grade, algebra, he explained something, you know, A plus B is C, that is not so easy to understand. So he explained, and then he asked the students, who got it? And then quite a number signed up, but a lot did not sign up. Then he asked, then he explained again and asked the other way around, who did not yet understand? Big amount signed up. Then he explained a third time and asked again. And almost the same number of hands went up. And then he said to me, I stand like a dog in the rain. We have a nice proverb, wie ein begossener Pudel. We just stand like a dog in the rain, not knowing what to do now. Shall I explain the fourth time? You know? And then one girl helped him. She signed up and said, but Mr. Klöckler, you explained it all three times.
The same.
All three times the same. Can you not understand that this is me? And he said to me that was his most powerful lesson in didactics. Because it's exactly the saying of Morgenstern. Each child has the right to meet the truth on his own pathway. Mm-hmm. And if a teacher thinks who is not taking the same road than me is a bit silly, shall take an extra teacher, you know, then he has not understood about truth. But when a teacher realizes I can be lucky if one third can follow me, more or less good, and then I can occupy and try to find out how to make accessible what I want to explain for the rest of the group. And he was teaching still in the 6-day time of the week. You know, now we have a 5-day week. And in ancient times, we had a 6-day week. So it was even more difficult to make an extra time. Today, one can just take the Saturday morning. But he took then the Saturday afternoon and invited each week, when he had a block, his students who did not understand to ask him questions. And he trained them. And so the students qualified him to become a more and more sensitive teacher for the needs of the children, for the specific blockades of the children. Because we can only learn from the children how to help them to find their ways. We cannot know it, we cannot learn it from books. We can only, what Steiner anywhere recommended, read the children's needs. But for this, we need to open our eyes and we need the will and the courage to see truth, the truth of this child, to observe. It's the way his thoughts, his feelings can be mobilized and what makes the child active, how skillful it is, and so on. And so he then managed to transform a horror subject like mathematics into a subject of success, which children really liked. So Georg, I'm sorry that I praise you a little bit, but for me this was very impressive as a young, unexperienced school doctor. And this eye-opener helped also me to see much more the teacher-student interaction. If this is beautiful, if this is harmonious. If this has a truth orientation, if this has a fundament of goodwill, I want to help you. I want to bring you forward. I want to understand. And if these two companions are there, then the relationship becomes beautiful. If we have real interest in one another, if this question, how are you, is not just a custom, but if this real interest combined with goodwill to do what I can do to help you on your path, then the relationships are becoming beautiful. So beauty is really this middle sphere which has so much to do with the social and is in reality the most difficult part, because we know so well what we dislike, but we find it not easy to overcome this and to create the beautiful. But I hope that we will also see that truth and goodness are not easy pathways, although for a first look, the beauty appears as the most difficult. So, I need now to control my time. I would like to start today with addressing the topic truth. I was given four keynotes, so I thought to do first truth, second beauty, third goodness, and fourth, how the I am is challenged to handle the three so that one can support the other. I would like first to make a little exercise with you. How can we find the truth? How can we teach the truth? How can we access truth in our normal everyday life? And I would like to do this based on some little examples of the curriculum. When I first studied the world of curriculum, I wondered why Rudolf Steiner pays so much attention in the first grade already to ask children, what do you have observed on your pathway in school? What did you newly experience yesterday? And if children are telling something, then exactly to ask, but how did look this person? What did this person wear? So to train clear memory, to train good observation memory, not only for what was said, but also how it was expressed. What, for example, if you ask a lot of students who are trained a little bit like that at home about the wear of the teacher, the wear of some students, they will have observed exactly, and they can tell you all the colors and the fashion. They have seen it. So what I want to say is, Rudolf Steiner wants from the first school day on to train good observation, clear observation, because that is the fundament of truth finding. The better I can observe, the clearer I can say, yes, that is so. Yeah. I got this wonderful I do not know the term.
They.
Yeah. With this specific color, and it's all natural plants, flowers from here. Unbelievable to see that. When I have seen, and then and you have seen now, and then you close your eyes, and you have a more or less clear picture of what it is. But what is this, what you do? This will disappear in 1 week. It will disappear, the beauty will be gone. But in your imagination, it is still fresh, as it was the first day. So one is to observe clearly, and every day is full of new observations, new experiences. But what are you doing with that? The second is that some of these experiences we take into our mind. And in the evening, when we do the review of the day, we have it in mind, we can see it again. And what we have done is to bring this, what we saw in the world around us, in the environment, into the invisible realm of thinking. We make something which is passing by, which will die one day, as everything in the world of the senses, and we give him eternal life in our thoughts. Thinking and observation are the basic tools to find truth. And observation is the first pillar associated to the physical environment. And the senses are the transmitters. So schooling the senses is the most essential for truth education. It's the fundament. And then please reflect what is the biggest attack of the media to avoid truth finding, to avoid a good schooling of the senses. And we forget that we have already the third, almost the third screen generation. The first screen generation came from the invention of TV. And the second, when all the channels were opened and you could see 24 hours TV. So it was intensified enormously. And in the third, you have everything on your mobile, in your pocket, during car driving. You do not observe yourself anymore. Your intention to make your own individual experiences is totally suppressed by a preformed input which makes out of you a mass human being, sharing with millions the same pictures, and these pictures are not true. They are not real. Form, color, sense impression only through eyes and ears. Touching is always the same touch. Has nothing to do with the object. All the senses are disintegrated. It is a huge sensory disintegration machine. And it suppresses the intention we need when we want ourselves to observe. And because this is already third generation, we have now many kids whose parents were already educated that way, and do not know what their kids are missing because they missed it already themselves. So therefore, if we want to do today something for truth, we really need to create our kindergartens and schools strictly media-free, screen-free, better to say. Medias we have a lot. This is also living media. But screen-free and reality-based as much as possible, because the environment is already so advanced in having the screens everywhere that there is no child protection possible. Only there where people feel responsible for child's development. And many parents really, in spite of all goodwill, they don't know. And they cannot change their minds so quickly. So, on the physical level, we have the senses with their input for truth, and that is observation. On the etheric level, what do we have on the etheric level? You know, Steiner's greatest finding, most of you know well, which is basis for anthroposophic medicine and for teaching, school, education. That is that he found the metamorphosis of the forces of growth into intellectual forces. He found the law that the same forces which make your body grow, regenerate, giving health, are the same forces, these etheric life-giving forces, we use for the life of our thinking, for our spiritual growth, healing, and health. This is a huge insight and gives the possibility to understand why meditative pathways, good thoughts, prayers for other people can support the health state. Because it is the same sheet serving both. And in my earlier visits here, we worked a lot on child development. And some of you know still this drawing, how the human body is growing up in the first 20 years about, and year by year you can observe in the growing up process new intellectual faculties. That is just how it is. You have Steiner's most beloved example, the teeth change together with abstract memory. He again and again refers to that as the main marker for school readiness, that children are ready when the teacher says something in school in the morning to remember this at home, even if they have heard it only once. That is school readiness. But where from this comes? You know, in my medical studies, I learned this second dentition is ready between 6 and 8. Then it starts, and then the second generation is ready, even if it's not yet all broken through in the mouth. But in the mandibula, in the maxilla, it's all prepared. Between 6 and 8, so the middle is 7, and that's exactly what you can observe if you have children in that age in your school. I observed it often when I met in first grade as an hospitating school doctor, when, for example, the first grade teacher announced at the end of the lesson, "Now we will hear this or that fairy tale." And when he was this lucky, I experience this minimum 3-4 times. Then he announces a fairy tale the children know already from kindergarten. And then you can see the maturity of teeth. One part of first grade is happy to hear this beautiful story again. They have not yet abstract memory. They have memory which lives in repetition, like a kindergarten child. Then you have those who are school ready, have already abstract memory, and they say, oh, that's boring. Why this old story? Yeah. They react aggressive. And then you have a bit of a polite middle group, which is neither excited nor aggressive. Yeah. And that is what Rudolf Steiner wanted to observe us. Can we observe the liberation process of the incarnation or embody activity of these spiritual members of us? They have first to make the body develop. But when this is done, they can liberate. And then they become the carrier of our soul and spiritual development. And therefore, when we look throughout this beautiful development, then we see not only these abstract thinking etheric forces liberate with 6-7 years, we see continuously between birth and 21-22 until growing process goes, each year new intellectual forces according to the organs which are formed through. And teeth is a special organ, therefore Steiner's most beloved example. Why? Because our teeth can never regenerate. We have not a third dentition. All people beyond 50 or 60 know what that means. More and more money for the dentist. Yeah. But for Steiner, this was therefore such a beautiful example, because if there is no chance for further regeneration, all the forces will liberate. And then we develop the spiritual fight to keep something in your mental, or in our mental teeth, so that we can abstractly remember independent of the location. But on the other hand, we can also learn to digest mentally, to work with that. We learn it year by year better to handle it. The more all the other organ functions are matured, our mental digestion process improves. And according with this, brain development. Rudolf Steiner's advice was to school the intellectual faculties along the readiness, how they liberate from the body, and to train the brain through physical activity, skillful physical activity, artistic, handcraft, harmonious movements, not yet sport in a hard way. It should only start in the middle grades that way, not in the first 3 grades. It's all about the brain development, because the brain develops as better we know this today through brain research. Now it's clear to everyone of goodwill, but in Steiner's time it was not yet known. One still believed the brain is developing more and more out of its genetic predisposition. Today we know the brain is an organ which can only develop in the encounter with the physical environment, in time and space. And if these experiences are not skillfully made, if the body has not a good space orientation, and if thinking and feeling have no clear contact to time processes, then the brain cannot live in reality. We have a big problem. These children have no clear mental orientation. So we have huge damages in our days already on the brain level because this is not trained. And when we are aging, we have the same process going on because every organ which is aging, not only the skin, also the other organs, liberate etheric forces, make us wiser and less beautiful. So that is how it is. So the most mental beauty we have in dying, then all the forces can liberate this physical body and enter into their spiritual journey after death. So before we are born, we form all these invisible bodies, connect with the germ, then we enter into our life in space and time, and then we leave again for eternity. And the carrier of this is the etheric. Because the etheric, as I try to explain, can build the bridge between the outer environment through the sense perception, which is an etheric touch, an etheric activity through all the senses. Steiner describes this in Study of Man. It's always the etheric body, which is loose in the sense organs, can leave, can touch. Therefore, in the evening, our senses are tired because the etheric is out and not within. The same with the brain. Our thinking capacity is around the brain. The brain is a reflector of thoughts. And in the evening, our head is tired. All the other organs beyond brain and sense organs do not need to sleep. We know this even today out of animal experiments. If you keep dogs as long awake with all pain and food and light and noise attacks on the senses until at the end they will break down and then you kill them, what researchers are doing, and then you make an analysis of the health state of all the organs, then you will find the brain and the sense organs almost destroyed, but all the other organs, perfect. They do not need to sleep. And that is what Rudolf Steiner describes. The etheric leaves the body, uses the organs from outside. Mental activity is not an organic activity, it's an organ abusing activity, a tiring, destructive activity. So our spiritual awareness is the result of a out-of-body activity of our etheric constitution. And we will come to the astral and the eye activity in its out-of-body form the same way. But the fundament, and that is the theme of this morning, is to understand a little bit the etheric body as the body of truth. No clear observation without copying it, what we observe etherically, so that we can represent it in our thinking. All our thoughts are the big mass of our thoughts are representations of sense experiences. We all know that, but we do not consider it enough. What that really means. You know, we think in representations. That's the biggest amount of our thoughts. But when we go beyond thinking in representations, we come to true thinking, which is independent from representations. And that is the second step of truth finding, that we think with our etheric body independent from the senses. And that is what we name philosophy. Thinking in concepts. Thinking in principles. Thinking in logic. Relationships. Thinking in mathematic terms. Thinking in geometrical terms, thinking in definitions. For example, a circle is not this. The definition of a circle that is, it is a location of all the points, innumerous points, who have the same distance from the middle point. And this definition is independent from sense perception, because I can make this definition and have a very small circle and central point in mind. I can make it as large as the cosmos. It's independent from space as the realm of the senses. Our thinking can enter into this space via the doorways of the senses and can leave the realm of space and purely think in its own realm. And that is this beautiful realm of pure, clear thinking, independent of sense perception. And this, dear friends, has to be trained in school enormously. Because in our materialistic life, academization, studies, where every thought needs to be based on a fact. You know, when I say Waldorf education is healthy, I had a nice encounter yesterday in this shoe shop here, in the little shopping center close by. And I was there looking for some shore sandals, because I have only these shoes and I thought I need some little flip-flops or how you say. So I went there and then this was a very nice man and I said, you are doing a good job and you are so friendly with your customers. He really was. And then we came a bit further in our conversation and I asked him, do you know, yes, he asked me, are you here for enjoyment, for holidays, and then I'm working here in the Waldorf school. Do you know the Waldorf school here? And then he said, yes, that is a well-known school in the department here. And then I said, what do you know about it? And then he said, oh, they make many things different. They are a sort of alternative education. And then I said, yes, do you know what sort of alternative they try? And he said, no, but I would love to know. And so I said to him, for me, I know it a little, the biggest difference is between the regular school system that they make the alternative to orient the education on the developmental needs of the children and not on the political and economic requirements of the society.
Oh, well said.
And then it was so nice how this gentleman radiated. He enjoyed that and said, wow, that is good. That is how it should be. Yeah. And then he told me a story that he came out of drug addiction and whatever curves into a good life, yeah, knowing what is the essential. And he found that is the essential. To look after what is human, after development, and not orienting all the life what is the latest requirements, and then just to follow all these requirements. Mm-hmm. So I found this really nice. Mm. Yeah. And I thought he is not far from that. Yeah. Maybe one day he will attend something here. He's now more curious, I hope. So that is the second step. Truth based on thinking through logic, through mathematics, through philosophy. Rudolf Steiner said, each youngster shall learn to write his own philosophy of freedom. Yeah. And he wanted to have more time to write another philosophy of freedom for young people. But he couldn't do it anymore in his lifetime. And then he said, the best would be if each one would write his own one. And that is really true. But these two fields, dear friends, we can really educate in school. By caring how we work with children's thinking, how we help them to develop observation, representation, conceptual thinking, characterizing thinking, all these pure thinking modalities according to the curriculum. Beautiful steps. But then a third step of truth finding comes, which need as underground these two. And that is truth you can only strive for and you will never find. We have not only facts. I need to finish one sentence. According to facts. I started when people asked me about Waldorf school. And I share with them that this is a health-promoting education. Then mostly they ask me, where do you have your reference? They do not want to understand, to think conceptually about development, about education. No, they want facts. The laziness in thinking is already so powerful in materialistic times that we only believe what is based on facts. That's the rest of truth which is left. And because facts are changing permanently according to latest news, latest research, we have meanwhile even fake news as part of our truth-finding facts. You have now to judge if this based on facts which can show the truth, or is this fake new truth based on facts which were nicely dressed up to show what I want to find or to explain you as the truth I found important now for this or that. Mm-hmm. So truth is not truth anymore. Truth is convention. Truth is intention. Truth is manipulation. Truth is a tool which can be handled to whatever purpose. And this is a necessary result out of a materialistic education and academic training which is only based on facts and not on thoughts. When thinking only serves the observation, and has lost its own dignity, has lost its own self-awareness, has lost its own capacity.
Therefore, Rudolf Steiner made the curriculum in that way, and you can find this when you look at it under this aspect, that thinking and observation should be trained in the first 6-7 school years, primarily. And then it goes on and on, but in puberty, we all know thinking and observation must be developed until the puberty change comes to a certain extent. Why is this so crucial? Because when the astral forces in process of puberty change are liberating from their work in the body, creating the gender differentiation and all this, and then they get free for feeling. When children start to live fully in their feelings and not anymore like pre-puberty children, innocently in their thoughts primarily, then their thought life must be educated so far that there is a certain support when the waves of the feelings are coming and you lose all trust in truth and all the doubts are coming and all the super personal experiences are coming, the interpretations are coming, yeah? That you start to talk and then afterwards endless to reflect if what you have heard is really true. Or you have afterwards the feeling what I said could be misunderstood. So you lose the sense for truth when truth finding becomes realistic on the level of your feelings. And you use your observation and your thinking to interpret your feelings and to explain others. So if there is not a solid ground also in the representation of your brain of clear thoughts and observations that you are based in the fundament of truth, then you will lose the sense for truth in puberty and come into this chaos that everything is relative and that there is a huge longing instead of knowing. So when this longing period, this wishing period, this doubting and insecurity period comes, based on individual feeling, which is still so in need of becoming developed, then, of course, students in this age are extremely endangered to lose trust in life, trust in friendship, trust in love, trust in parents, and so on. So therefore, we need to have in mind when we want to meet truth on the astral level, on the emotional level, then truth becomes a goal. And not something you can find here and now. And for this, we have a beautiful philosophical parable by Lessing, who was a German philosopher in the time of the French Revolution, when thinking was the highest virtue. And there he makes this parable saying, the education of humanity And he describes the education of humanity. And then he closes this beautiful story, how the mental development of humanity took place. He closes this parable, no, he closes this description with a beautiful parable, saying, if God would ask me, what do you want? Here in my right hand, I have all the truth of the world. I'm ready to give it to you. And here in my left hand, I have the eternal striving for truth. You will never fully reach it. And he would ask me, what would you like to choose? Then I would bow my knees, fall in his left hand and say, give me that truth I can for eternity strive for, because the full truth is only for you. But I really must say, dear friends, when I read this first in my Waldorf school time, I thought, I would have done the other way around. I would have asked for the right hand. Yeah, because I suffered already so much from this, yeah, what is really, and so on and so forth. And then to have the choice to get everything at once, you know, a remarkable idea. But when I grew older, then more and more I realized, no, Lessing is right. I will follow rather Lessing's decision. Why? Because imagine you would have everything one can learn as a human being right away, you would be at the end of your development.
Yeah.
You are at the dead end. So it's not the way, but what is the way is to experience the astral body as the body of becoming. Of becoming a total individual, true human being. Why are we all individual? Because of our feelings. We are not individual because of our physical and etheric forces. We are individuals because each of us has its own way for truth, has an individual relationship with facts. Some facts in research are speaking to me enormously, and for other people not. Mm-hmm. They are attracted by total other results of this or that finding. So what makes us individuals is our destiny, of course, which is even for one egg twins different. Our individualization process is not based on hereditary, on environment. It is based primarily on our individual destiny. But we experience our individual destiny primarily through our astral body, which makes it for us individually conscious. Goethe said, if you don't feel it, you will never understand it. Rudolf Steiner says in his Theosophy, only through our feelings, thoughts and concepts become relevant for us. If you don't feel the beauty of an insight, it is not relevant for you. It will pass by. Mm-hmm. What makes it attractive for you is the way you feel about it. So we will come to all this topic of the astral in the next keynote. But under the aspect of truth, we need already to understand on the astral level, truth is a goal, something we are longing for, a real self-understanding, who am I as a human being? Who is really the other person I'm living with, or I'm in friendship or in working contact with? We never reach the end because we are all in development and changing. Our mind, our consciousness is changing. So that is the astral quality of truth, that we become more and more truthful and that we understand one another more and more. And even students, when they grow older, in most of the schools, one class starts one day also to reflect, shall we not write also an annual report about our teachers?
Yeah.
And then they write how Mr. So-and-so, gym teacher or handcraft teacher or whatever subject teacher, has developed in this year quite nicely. Has managed, he learns now to handle difficult so-and-so much better. We acknowledge that. Yeah, brave soul, go ahead like this, good direction. It is not only that we as teachers make reports, no, and see. No, they also see our change.
Mm-hmm.
And that our interaction has footprints in the teacher. And that is this astral level, where we build on one another, how we awake in the interaction for one another, and so on. But then we have a fourth level, and that is related to our eye organization. And that is a truth aspect which is very touching for ourselves. Because in accordance to these aspects, here we have observations, then representations, concepts, then wishes, desires, hopes. And on the I level, truth becomes an ideal. What is an ideal? It is as a exceptional thought as representations are, because they are drawn from the physical world, from the sense perception. Ideals are drawn out of the spiritual world and transformed into a thought. You know, when Christ says in the Gospels, I am the truth, or I am the path, the truth, and life, then he relates his being with a thought. And this thought is for us, as humans, a simple thought, but only simple if we do not take it serious. It becomes an exceptional thought when we identify with that thought. So ideals are thoughts who have their meaning only in the power of identification. If you don't identify with an ideal, you don't have it.
Mm-hmm.
It is not an ideal. Then it is a simple idea, a nice concept.
Yes.
Oh, it's good if people are true. It's very nice. Yeah. But it has nothing to do with me.
Mm-hmm.
But when this idea, this concept is touching you, that you feel a call. I should become more truthful. I maybe should train a bit honesty. Then it is more than a thought. But now not in relation to this beautiful real world, this analog world down out there. No. Then thinking touches beings. As on the other side, thinking is touching objects when I observe them. So thinking reveals as a huge bridge between the world of the senses and the world of the spiritual beings. And the specific quality of an ideal is that I connect with a being. And therefore, if you identify with a good thought, with an ideal like truth, then the being of truth, the Godhood itself, can strengthen you.
Mm-hmm.
Because you identify with a force of a being. But the bridge is this good idea, I could train my honesty furthermore. And the interesting thing is, if people train, for example, honesty, one day someone in their environment will see that and will say, wow, you are honest. I would not have dared to say this, for example. So what does this mean? First, you think honesty. Second, you are in a situation that you think, no, that is more. I want to become honest.
Mm-hmm.
And you identify with this thought and make it your ideal. Then you experience this ideal give you strength. It enlivens you. It inspires you. So that in certain situations you are more honest than you were before. You are more aware. You become more sensitive. And so on. And then finally another person says, you are honest. So you become as a being what was before only a thought.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have the bridge between the outer world and the inner world, the superficial world and the essential world. And that is the pathway to find truth. World of education want to lead the students. And the more we understand these different levels of truth, the better we can use the tools of our curriculum to help the students to become more and more oriented and sure on these different levels. But when we look at this more from a medical side, this is the pedagogical side, then I must say it is the most important concept for all those who want to work with healing, with transformation, with help, with support and all that. Because what is health? Health is not the opposite of illness. Illness is an attack to our health. Every day we have to suffer lots of influences to make us ill. They can come from the environment, poisoned air, not clean enough water, nutrition problems, but also emotional problems. We can live in relationships which make us ill. So many factors are playing, and then a huge resource of illness is autoaggression, that we hate ourselves, mm-hmm. that we hate our destiny. So self-harm, self-hate is also a big force undermining our health. And all this works every day.
Mm.
And beautifully, we have forces of healing, self-healing. And they compensate more or less good what we have lost. So the so-called healthy human being is in the middle between healing resources and attacking resources. You have not 2 hours in your life the same health state, dear friends. Your health is permanently changing. And you are as healthy as you feel yourself. There are no objective criteria what is healthy and what is a healthy human being. Doha Goodwood, she was a famous anthroposophic actor in the 70s and 80s of the last century on the Goetheanum stage. And when she then retired from the stage, she traveled a lot in Waldorf schools and gave classes in teach formation and in drama. Yeah, some of us have experienced her. Yes, me too. Georg too. You too. That's really nice. And she was Schwäbin. She spoke the specific German of South Germany. Not on stage, but in privacy. And so, in one of these courses for teacher, we also invited her in the school. I was school doctor in Witten. And then one day she said, because one teacher wanted to have a speech exercise to become more strong, another to be more awake. You know, she was very interested also in use the tools of speech formation as a tool for health promotion. So they had all these wishes, and then it was a bit too much for her. She said, you know, and I will say it first in Schwäbisch, Sie müssen gar nicht so sehr gesund sein, gesund zu wirken. You don't need to be so enormous healthy in order to appear healthy. You can even appear healthy if your health state is not perfect. It depends so much on how you handle it. And of course, she was right. We know this. It's everyday experience in medical practice. How many patients feel already better when they arrive in the hospital or in the consultation? Even the symptoms are gone, which makes them then angry because the doctor cannot. Where from does this come? Only because you relax. You have the good feeling, I'm now helped. The fear is disappearing. You know, your astral body can liberate from the physical. You feel
better
and your body says thank you. And we can do this, of course, also out of our own understanding. So we have resources for health on all these levels, resources making us ill, but the etheric body, who is the regulator of all these forces, via the so-called four ethers. The etheric body regulates the physical via life ether, the etheric via chemical ether, the astral via light ether, and the eye via warmth ether. So the etheric body really is the health promoter in our body. And that is the organization with which we think, the carrier of truth. Therefore, health and truth is the same.
Mm-hmm.
And you see the physician only if something is wrong with you. We even have it in our language. If something is missing, if something is wrong. You know, it's all the wording we have if we don't find truth.
Mm-hmm.
If there's an error, if there's something missing, yeah, we have to go on. So what is health? A wonderful resonance between all the organs. Each organ has a clear perception of the activity state of the others and is adjusting to that. We name it the resonance between the organs. And when we become ill, there is a lack of resonance between the organs. Then this inter-organic communication between cells, in the organ itself, between the organs, and then coordinated by heart and brain, the whole working of all the organs in a harmonious, healthy interaction is somewhere disturbed. And then we can understand why we can influence our health state, not only through remedies, but also through many different meditative strivings and pathways. Because the same members with which we are active in our thinking, feeling, and will are the ones who have to be regulated in our body in order to keep us healthy. It is the same systems we use from two different sides, or we handle mentally and physically and on the soul level. And there is one very important aspect for teachers and doctors to be understood. But first I need to check, yes, I have still a bit time left before we have then the event of the announcements. As a transition between something, I try to make it as serious as I can, and lunch, which is then very private. So we will have a bridge in between, and therefore I ask you to keep the serious good so that you not lose it before he will lead us in other spheres. But it's still my turn, Roland. And I am then looking forward to your work. So that is the beautiful threefold human being. And this works different during day and during night. The night life has another truth than the day life. The day life has the truth that we have a certain perspective, emotionally, the way we think and have observed and interpreted. And this is, of course, total along our own opinion. During the night, we experience the truth of the others, but unconscious, of course. If not, we would get crazy. But sometimes we have this after sound in the morning that we do not press the send button of an email, we took overnight or over two nights, or that we think, ah, maybe I need to contact this person, I left in concern. So we quite often have an after sound in the morning that overnight our visions, our opinion was slightly changed. And we look at some things differently. Because there is a night teaching. It is not only so that we need the night so that what we learned during the day becomes organic and memorable and becomes faculty. So that is a process which goes night by night. The night is as important for learning as the day. But it is also that during the night we experience the other half of truth. My own way to find truth, and also what the other experienced by the way I lived and worked with them. And Rudolf Steiner describes that the sleep life is different in the first 9 years of life. That the real sleep life starts only in puberty. And what is the real sleep life? That when we sleep in, the astral body and primarily, now I share it for the astral body. The astral body is able to reach out during the night in the cosmos, in the spiritual homeland. And the etheric body will not do that. The etheric body during the night goes into our nerve system and sense organ to regenerate that. Because through the thinking activity, what I tried to explain a little bit, sense organs and nerve systems are destroyed. During the night, they are regenerated from within, and therefore we do not think during the night. And this process that during the night the etheric forces are going in for regeneration and the astral forces and later also the eye forces stay out of body when they have liberated. That mature adult sleep life starts in puberty. And therefore, in the first lecture of Study of Man, Rudolf Steiner describes this topic, which is so difficult to understand, that the teacher in the first years of school must teach the students to sleep. You know, when I read this verse, I really had to laugh. Yes. In school, children shall be awake. Why shall they get a good teaching about sleep? You know, I really couldn't understand what that means. But going deeper, and particularly through my medical studies, I understood better and better. Because when children are not yet so mature that the eye and astral forces are liberated out of the developing process of the body, only the etheric forces are liberated. Then eye organization and astral organization are still 100% oriented to develop the physical body. They are not yet out of body, liberated, and ready for sleep. Therefore, Rudolf Steiner says, the way teachers are connected with truth, they can compensate by a teaching which is as much honest as possible, as much connected with the essential and the spiritual world, which is the essential world, as possible. Or with other words, if a teacher really knows what he's talking about and feels connected with what is behind his words, with the true meaning, then this replaces for the children their inability to go to the essential world, to the other beings during the night, which is not yet possible. So it takes time, puberty, until the astral fully can go into the spiritual world during the night and to the other human beings to see the truth, the other side of truth, and the same for the eye organization, which comes later, successively. And in the time before that liberation, the teacher must, through his own adulthood and connectedhood with the world of truth, the world of the essential, he brings into the classroom through the subjects, must give the children this good feeling, what I learn here is essential, is rooted in the real world, in the physical and in the spiritual. And then the sleep of these children is much more healthy. And for me, knowing this, it becomes more and more touching when I read almost every month new studies about the growing sleeping disorders of children. Mm-hmm. And this is not only the noise, and that everything is more hurried up and so on. It is associated in these research documents a lot with the media. That is the sleep killer, not only because it keeps children longer awake when they cannot get rid of and they are more and more addicted, but even if children have enough hours to sleep, but they watched too many hours during the day on their screens, they are not nourished and prepared for sleep. Mm. And the sleep is superficial, not really nourishing, not really health-giving. So this is something we need more and more to be aware of, that what we learn through anthroposophy is not only nice to have, let me put it so, and a bit relative. Yeah? There are some in the faculty who study Steiner, but this is not a must, and so on. Of course, it's difficult. It's not easy, you know, if we, yeah, we know how it is. But I'm convinced that in the nearer future, it becomes even more necessary that we really understand how the human development goes further and is realized or manifest itself. We need to know that when we want to understand why so many new problems are appearing in youngsters and adults who are endangered to lose their humanity. And we are, of course, now at the threshold that the drugs become legalized. I'm fully behind that because it will reduce drug criminality and so on. And you know how it was in America before the alcohol was allowed and became accepted, fully accepted by the society. The danger is that we have an alcoholized society. This is, of course, horrible. But the good thing is that the criminality is gone. But we are now at the threshold that to take drugs will become the normal. And this is even more horrible than the alcoholization of the society. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, what the mainstream is doing becomes normal even if it's ill. Even if it's not at all healthy. But it becomes normal if the majority is doing that. But then humanity will degenerate more and more. And we shall not wonder why. So I think there is a huge call to understand more the conditions, how human beings can develop healthily. And one is, of course, to study child development. But the other is also to study the conditions for human beings' healthy development, for adult learning. And there I would like, at my last point, to recommend in Rudolf Steiner's book, Knowledge of Higher World, which is among the volumes, the number 10, there you find one chapter, and this chapter has the title Conditions for the Inner Path. And there Rudolf Steiner describes 7 conditions for healthy development. One condition for the physical body, 2nd for the etheric, 3rd for the astral, 4th for the eye, 6th for spirit self, 5th for spirit self, 6th for spirit life, and 7th for spirit man. When you read this, you see every learning has conditions. And when I want to become a truth-oriented human being, I need to keep conditions. I'm always the result of the conditions I live in. If I do not learn the traffic rules, I cannot drive a car. These are the conditions. And that's for everything, even for the humanization process. And I think children of today, youngsters of today, need more and more adults who are learning themselves how to develop their humanity. And truth is the fundament of everything which has the name human. And therefore, I hope you will enjoy to read this chapter newly. I'm sure most of you know it well, because it is an eye-opener for also to develop towards more truthfulness in life and in the way you handle yourself. And I would like to close my attempt to contribute something to the concept of truth in education, in self-education, and a little bit in health promotion with this verse Rudolf Steiner gave for teachers and doctors together, so that they learn to support one another in this difficult work to help children and young people to humanize and to create a better world. And this is a bit the Kulisko Manifest, let me put it so, because Kulisko was one of these doctors who received that verse, and he was the first who tried to support teachers in their daily work. Once in olden times, there lived in the souls of the initiates powerfully the thought that by nature every person is ill, and education was seen as the healing process which brought to the child, as it matured, health for life's fulfilled humanity. Thank you for your patience and your listening.